The federal government is shut down, but is it affecting life in Oskaloosa? We talk to local officials and find out. RAGBRAI is long gone, but find out how the event will affect the community in the future. A beverage in Oskaloosa received a unique nomination this week. We'll tell you more.
From Oskaloosa's television news source, CRI Weekly News starts right now.
Thanks for joining us. I'm Aaron Riggs. Evidence of the federal government shutdown can be seen locally here in Oskaloosa. The post office is still open, but other federal agencies like the United States Department of Agriculture's Farm Services Agency is closed. The agency is located north of town. It's closed due to the lapse in federal funding. The closure means farmers won't receive a subsidy payment that otherwise would have been sent out on October 1st. Farmers that are part of the CRP program or are signed up to receive a direct payment won't be getting a check until the office reopens. Not all USDA workers are on furlough. USDA food inspectors are classified as essential personnel. That means they must continue to work despite the shutdown. Oskaloosa Food Products uses inspectors on a daily basis, and because of the essential personnel classification, it hasn't had any interruptions to its business. Another federal program that's affected by the government shutdown is the Nutritional Program for Women, Infants, and Children, or WIC. That program distributes checks to qualifying women who then purchase certain food items like baby formula. Officials say the Iowa WIC program has enough money to distribute new checks until the end of the month. But after that, users of the WIC program will start to see an impact.
As the shutdown goes on, there will be no more checks released. Most patients have received their October, some have received their November checks, but until the shutdown is over, those patients that receive WIC benefits will be impacted.
If the shutdown continues into November, checks that have been distributed and received will still be honored. The Oskaloosa School District may feel the effects of the shutdown. Oskaloosa Elementary is a Title I school, meaning the district receives federal dollars that are used for specialized education services there. The district also receives federal funding that goes toward the district's free and reduced lunch program. Those programs aren't affected now, but could be, depending on how long the shutdown lasts.
If it's less than 30 to 45 days, I don't think we'll have much of an issue. If it's any more than 60, definitely we're going to see some potential decrease in revenue.
Others affected include those who are members of the military. The shutdown is the result of different opinions between Washington Republicans and Democrats. That's regarding changes to the Affordable Care Act, known as Obamacare. And speaking of health care, individuals who are currently without health insurance can now sign up for health care coverage through the Affordable Care Act's new Health Insurance Marketplace website. The federal government opened the online marketplace on Tuesday. The Affordable Care Act is also called Obamacare. It's brought on a lot of changes to health care in America, one of which is the online marketplace. And it may require action from you. CRI talked with local experts to find out who should take advantage of the marketplace right now.
You can access the marketplace online at www.healthcare.gov.
It's right now focused towards individuals,
especially those who currently don't have health insurance. That's because the health care law requires all Americans to have health insurance starting in 2014.
There are going to be many, many applicants who have not been able to have insurance, maybe for many years, because of maybe a pre-existing health condition that either made the cost too high or they simply could not find a carrier.
For some, a federal subsidy is available to help with the cost of insurance.
Family of four making less than $90,000 qualifies.
And for a family of two, that's less than $62,000. Those who already have health insurance may visit the marketplace out of curiosity.
Some that are going to check it out to see if it's less costly for them to obtain it through the exchange than it is through their employer's plan.
Most employers pay a portion of an individual's premium for insurance, but if you get insurance through the marketplace, you'll forfeit your employer's contribution.
Sometimes the employer pays half or three quarters of the premium. So it will probably help people realize what a wonderful benefit they already have with their employers.
Those buying insurance at the website won't find Blue Cross and Blue Shield as an insurance provider, even though it sells about 86% of Iowa's individual health insurance plans.
So if you want to utilize a subsidy for Blue Cross Blue Shield insurance this year, that's not going to work. They chose to wait a full year before they joined the exchange.
Instead, Iowa's healthcare marketplace will sell insurance from two other companies.
They each have multiple plans, and I think there are actually 42 options on different plans that they can purchase.
For some, that might be a lot to take in.
A little bit intimidating sometimes when you have to go to a website, put in your income, put in your family information, which is what they would have to do.
But to help with the stress, Ratcliffe says local help is available.
You know, there are a lot of good health insurance agents in town. Obviously, I think any of them would be able to give them advice and help them.
Soon, residents can find help at Mahaska Health Partnership. It's in the process of becoming a certified application counselor.
Once our staff go through the training to become a certified application counselor, we'll have the ability to work one-on-one with patients to be able to help them sign up for the different plans that'll be available through the marketplace. If that's an option that they want to take, we'll be well educated in helping them do that. Otherwise, if we find that they're eligible for other insurance products like Medicaid or Medicare, we'll also help them get enrolled in those.
Those who buy insurance on the exchange won't see their new coverage start until January 1st. But that's only if you buy it before December 15th. Those that don't sign up for health insurance by March 31st of next year will incur a penalty fee. That's when open enrollment for the exchange ends. A new restaurant is setting up shop in Oskaloosa. The former Wang's location has been purchased, and a new Chinese restaurant will open there in 3 weeks. Restaurant manager Peter Pei came to Oskaloosa from Albia. Before that, he lived in Warsaw, Missouri. In both places, he managed Chinese restaurants. He is originally from the Shandong province in China.
Oskaloosa is a big town in my mind, so comparing with Albia. So it's 12,000 population here, so just one Chinese restaurant running on currently. I think there is business here, and also we need to bring a new flavor to town. So let local people have more choice.
Pei says there is a lot of work to be done to the kitchen, floors, and plumbing. He hopes to be open for business every day from 11 to 9. The Chinese restaurant will offer a buffet and dinner menu. The name of the venue isn't set in stone, but Pei says he's considering calling it Hot Pot Lot. They came and they went. Now the community will be able to see benefits from RAGBRAI's overnight stay. More than $18,000 in RAGBRAI revenue has been divided among various nonprofits, the public school district, the Chamber of and Development Group, and Oskaloosa Tourism. CRI's Presley Joss breaks down what the groups plan to spend the money on.
RAGBRAI brought in more than 15,000 people. With smiles on their faces, they enjoyed the entertainment, the food, and the hospitality Oskaloosa has to offer.
You heard a lot of thank yous, a lot of happy people.
But behind the smiles were committees, residents, and hundreds of volunteers that made the day possible.
So after it's all done, what are we doing? Well, we got a lot of money left over.
Now, some of the hard work put into RAGBRAI is being rewarded. More than $18,000 of leftover profit is being divided among nonprofits, the Oskaloosa Public School District, the Oskaloosa Chamber and Development Group, and Oskaloosa Tourism. The Chamber gets $9,448.09. The Tourism Committee, $2,362. MCRF also receives $2,362. And the Oskaloosa Public School District, $4,724. But what will these groups do with the money? Oskaloosa Schools Superintendent Russ Ryder says the students will benefit from this money.
And we're going to try to take those dollars from the RAGBRAI profits and allow kids to experience some great things outside of the classroom, go on these field trips, whether it be to Des Moines or surrounding communities, and you know, provide some opportunities for those children.
$9,448.09.
Chamber Finance Manager Deb Bruxford says it's up to the Chamber and Main Street Board of Directors to decide what to do with their portion of the money, but says the community will see it put to good use.
I think it'll be extras, things that we normally wouldn't have in our budget, and things that the community will enjoy and things that visitors will enjoy. It won't go into just office things, just say. I know that we're looking at some new Christmas banners, some new American flag banners. A lot of those are showing a lot of wear. And these dollars will be could be used as matching dollars for grants. So hopefully we can take these dollars and double them in many cases. Tourism brochures, marketing type of things.
Right now we're in the process of looking at a brochure that will showcase some of the activities and events in Oskaloosa.
Babra says MCRF's portion of the money will go towards attracting more visitors into Oskaloosa, who she hopes will then spread money in Oski's local shops.
Once we get the people hooked with our little brochure that says, oh, wow, that's going on, then we can get them to look around town.
Now that the final part of RAGBRAI has been completed, everyone involved in the experience can reflect back to the day Oskaloosa's population doubled.
The reputation of Oskaloosa was enhanced by 15,000 people who left saying that Oskaloosa was a great place.
The whole RAGBRAI experience was something that, you know, our town can be proud of, first of all. A lot of people came together, worked really hard, and I think it benefited our town in so many ways, on so many levels. It definitely brought the town together.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm Presley Joss.
The money also reimbursed nonprofits that had to pay vendor fees at RAGBRAI. Oskaloosa's Relay for Life is making some changes for next year's event. Relay for Life is a community fundraiser that raises money in the fight against cancer. Next year, changes include holding the event in March instead of June and conducting the walk at the Penn Activity Center instead of the square. The kickoff to next year's event occurred on Tuesday at Smoky Row. Relay for Life features a survivor's lap and a luminaria ceremony to remember those who have died from cancer. All cancer survivors at the event take the first lap around the track to celebrate surviving cancer. Relay for Life Chair Wyatt Russell hopes the new committee, along with the recent changes, will help raise donations and increase community involvement.
But we really want to roll out and get the community involved. We're really reaching out to local businesses, and we've reached out to the school district and everything like that. We're going to reach out to William Penn as well. We really want to make it a community event again and get a whole bunch of people involved with it.
If you want to participate, you can register online at relayforlife.org, then create a team or join an existing one. The registration fee is $10 per person. Anyone who raises at least $100 receives a t-shirt. The Relay for Life walk will occur on March 29th and last from 2 p.m. to 2 a.m. A bar in Oskaloosa received an important nomination this week, Best Bloody Mary in America. The Bloody Mary is the creation of Cellar Peanut Pub owner Marty Duffy. The nomination is part of the contest Thrillist's 2013 search for America's Best Bloodies. Duffy, who is originally from New Jersey, is one of eight finalists across the United States that will be featured at the New York City Food and Wine Festival. Duffy is the only representative from Iowa. His wife, Betsy, submitted the application for the contest. After that, Peanut Pub customers and Oskaloosa residents voted the beverage as the finest Bloody Mary in the states.
I never thought that people would vote for this. I'm humbled just the fact that people voted for this. It's amazing to be able to go to New York City and show off, you know, my Bloody Mary that I've been making for 10 years. It's awesome. My Bloody Mary, I just want someone to enjoy it, you know what I'm saying? So therefore, when I make a Bloody Mary, you know, I just want word of mouth. I want you to go and tell somebody, man, that was a great Bloody Mary. That's always been my kind of my little secret, to make a good Bloody Mary. It's fun. I mean, you have to have a passion for it, and you have to be creative, and that's what I try to do. So yeah, that's my little secret, I guess.
The New York City Food and Wine Festival will be held from October 17th to October 20th. The judges from the show Chopped will pick the winner, who will then receive a cash prize. Coming up next, it's homecoming at William Penn. Find out how students and alumni are celebrating the event statesman style. The Wilcox Library at William Penn Campus is providing the community with a unique experience to go back in time with a pictorial history.
William Penn's Wilcox Library has put into place a series of pictures that showcases the history of Penn and how the university fits into the pivotal social moments that shaped the nation. Wilcox Library opened in 1964 and was named after its biggest donor, Edgar Wilcox, who graduated in 1900. The purpose of the picture display was partly due to remodeling in the ground floor section. As a result, a number of additions have been made to accommodate students and community members. The new features include a number of whiteboards and seats with side tables for personal revision. The exhibit is a great way to go through the history of Penn and connect with the events in the nation and community. Since its founding in 1873, William Penn, at the time called Penn College, had enrolled students of all nationalities, races, gender, and religion. The pictures found on the ground floor display various graduating classes from as early as 1900s. Other features include the various sports teams and their accomplishments.
We selected a number of images from our digital archives project and we had them enlarged. We've written narratives about each image so community and students can come down to our lower level. And if they can go through and look at all the images, and it tells the story of William Penn's history. And we just thought it was a wonderful way to get our current students interested in the history of the college and also the history of the society, friends, and their experiences in Iowa.
Dr. David Potter, a noted history author and professor at William Penn, mentioned how the university was heavily involved in social issues.
Women's suffrage, Penn has always been interested in terms of the role of women. Women have played a substantial role in terms of Penn's history, including the very first class at William Penn. William Penn's first graduate was a woman graduate.
Penn was at the forefront of a number of social movements, such as women's suffrage and the fight against racial discrimination. At the time, Penn College girls organized the Penn Girls Equal Suffrage League in January of 1916. During the period of 1943 to 1949, the president of Penn College, Cecil Henshaw, fought issues of racial discrimination and encouraged the students to make the world a better place. The oldest picture on display is of the Old Main, the biology laboratory. The picture reflects the Society of Friends principle of equality and peace. For CRI Weekly News, this is Esther Luakabamba.
The exhibit is on permanent display on the ground floor of Wilcox Library and is open to the public. Also during homecoming week, students and alumni have been embracing their school spirit more than ever. CRI's Taylor Reed gives us a recap of the events leading up to the big football game this Saturday.
Homecoming is about much more than just football. It's a time for alumni, staff, and students to get together and show pride for their school. William Penn does this through a series of events and activities leading up to the big game. Kicking off homecoming this week was the Mr. and Mrs. Statesman competition Monday. Winning this year's crowns were senior statesmen Samantha West and Tracy Curry. Other activities this week included mud volleyball, powder puff football, and a hypnotist. Although the week is filled with games and prizes, there is a lot of work going on behind the scenes, says Penn Activity Center Director Levi Tarbell.
I supervise all of the events. I mean, they're ran from the student government, at least the student events are, that is. So I monitor all those and make sure they go over well. As far as the homecoming events that are for the alumni, we'll set up for those and just make sure everything's prepared, communicate back and forth with the advancement office to make sure all their requests are met.
Despite the stress of making sure the week goes smoothly, Tarbell looks forward to his week as an alum.
My favorite part is seeing my past teammates. A few of them roll in every year. There's a few I haven't seen since I graduated, so my favorite time is spending with my former teammates and seeing other teammates and other friends meet up with each other and interact, or your difference between an alumni who is now 80 years old versus an alumni who is 25 and just got out. And that's really cool to see that connection as well.
Getting current students involved is only part of what goes on during homecoming. The other half is left up to the advancement office, which makes a huge effort to welcome back graduates.
When you're here, you're really part of the family, and that's one great thing about being at William Penn and the smallness that we have, some people call it. To me, it's more of the family atmosphere, and I see that right now with the students I deal with phone-a-thon, with sports, with activities that I get involved in. So once they leave, they miss that family. So homecoming is just an opportunity to really literally bring them home.
Dursky says one way the university plans on greeting former students is with some friendly competition.
Saturday morning, we'll have a lot of alumni games, the softball team, basketball, wrestling. A lot of those groups do alumni games. And so I've seen all over Facebook. It's like, okay, we're going to be sore on Monday, but we're going to do this. And so, you know, they're all talking about hope there's trainers on the sidelines and stuff like that. So a lot of excitement is in the air for homecoming this year.
As the week's festivities wind down, William Penn's football team is gearing up to give staff, students, and visiting alumni another reason to celebrate. For CRI Weekly News, I'm Taylor Reed.
If you missed all the action this week, join William Penn students and staff this Saturday, October 5th, as the number 22 ranked Statesmen take on number 11, St. Ambrose. Head coach Todd Hafner says slowing down quarterback Eric Williamson and the St. Ambrose offense will be a priority.
To shut down Eric Williamson Saturday, we're going to need full focus with all-out effort. I have every bit of confidence in our guys that we're going to go out Saturday and get it done. Are you going to shut him down? Probably not. But can you contain him and limit what they do? I think we can. That's a big part of what you try and do when you're facing great players.
Hafner also says there's a possibility injured starting quarterback Taylor Parsons will redshirt this season. He's not playing due to a torn MCL. This would give Parsons an extra year of eligibility. Kickoff for the homecoming game is scheduled for 1:30 p.m. You can watch the game live on MCG Channel 7. Coming off a big win against Norwalk, the Oskaloosa High School football team will hit the road looking for its fourth straight win. The 3-2 Indians will travel to take on 2-3 Keokuk at 7:30 p.m. tonight. Head coach Mike Sterner talked about his running back, Andrew Langrebe, and gave us the scouting report on Keokuk.
He's very explosive. He's kind of lightning in a bottle of sorts. He's very explosive, and if our offensive line gives him a chance, he will find that crease, and sometimes he finds creases that aren't there in different places and reverses field or things like that. One of those moments where we say, no, okay, go. Well, Keokuk's a dangerous team. They have not had a lot of success this year. They do have some pretty talented things. Their wide receivers are a pretty talented group of kids. Their kicker is just outstanding. I think he puts just about everything right in the end zone, and he does the punting for them as well. It'll be a challenge for our kicking game this week, and it'll be a challenge for our defensive backs, who've just got to continue to improve.
Langrebe has rushed for 1,041 yards, good for seventh in the state, to go along with 15 touchdowns for the Indians. And that's the CRI Weekly News for today, October 4th, 2013. We know you have many choices for news, so from all of us at the Communication Research Institute of William Penn University, we thank you for choosing us as a local news source. Our next newscast is next Friday at 6:30, right here on MCG Channel 12. We leave you now with a look at the past week through photos provided by OskyNews, our coverage partner. We'll be right back.
Stay up to date on all the news happening in Oskaloosa by following CRI Weekly News online at www.critv.org, facebook.com/CRI Weekly News, and Twitter @CRI Oskaloosa.